Okay, how you doing, guys? So now after the epic videos that you guys are watching there before, hoping this one here's not going to be as long. It might be, I don't know. I haven't finished filming it yet. What's next? As you can see, I've taken everything off, vehicles and such. The realistic water that I tried, this experiment here, came out wonderfully. I think it looks perfect. I think that if you build it up in several layers, it would look absolutely astounding for standing water. I have stuff to do water effects as well, so that'll be another experiment for later. But I have another product I could use for doing water, so those beads you have to heat up. I don't know what those will be like. I don't know, this realistic water, it does it for me. I don't think I need to use another product. It seems to do it. So what I'll do to this is I will brush on some gloss onto this to make it look moist, and then dry brush a mud color over it so it hits all the high points. And the two textures, the dry of the paint combined with the wet look of the gloss, should make it look like it's wet. At least that's the hope anyway. And then the high gloss of the realistic water will look like standing water. That's what I'm going to call it. Beedo. Yes, there we go. Today is my daughter's 6th birthday. That's what that was telling me. I already knew that though. So right now, this is green patina. It is a couple of different colors of green oil paint mixed together with some thinner. And I'm going to add it to the bottom part of the shed here to give it a little bit of that algae kind of look. I don't know how well you guys will be able to see it, but that's not all I'm going to do. One thing I did that was off camera is I added more grass, static grass, up here, along the back, along in here, and up and through here. And I'm happier with the way it looks now. I may add more later, not sure yet. We'll see. This is a fairly simplistic thing to do. Just dab it on. And in a regular pattern, let it soak into the wood. And when it's dry, it looks like algae. I've done this many times now, and I like the effect. It tends to climb up quite a bit in corners, so when you're doing it, darken the corners a bit more, like the inside corners, not the outside corners. Outside corners, it's not as much. Do more than just the bottom board. Trying to keep the paintbrush out of the grass. Using the capillary action to pull it down. Now, this is a really subtle effect. Something you only see if you're really looking for it, but it's something your eye sees, but you won't see unless you're looking for it kind of thing. I've seen it on dozens and dozens of dioramas. And the only reason I saw it is because I was looking at the dioramas for a really long period of time. And I noticed it. So, this isn't a new technique, and it's certainly not mine. Everything I do, I don't lay claim to. I never invented any of these things. I doubt you'll be able to see this part. I've never had an original thought. So all that needs to be done for that. All right, so what's next is more scatter. Bits of leaf and tiny bits of I don't really know what to call it. You could probably just leave it the way it is, but I don't know, I need to do more than that. So first thing I'm going to use is parsley flakes. Don't need many of these because they're a little bit too green, right? Just scatter them here and there. That's a bit more color. Breaks up the uniformity. Putting it mostly on the bramble right now. So I want it to be caught in it and fall underneath onto the ground below. Thing is, you have concentrations of it, but then you have to put it everywhere else too, but in smaller concentrations. So if you put it in all the bramble, you still have to spread it in all the other places around the diorama in little tiny bits, because it has to be, there has to be a flow to it, right? If you just put clumps of it and not tie it together, it doesn't look very natural. This is unground thyme. This is really good for forest floor stuff. But it looks pretty cool when it's caught in the bramble. after I spray, or after I put all this on, I have to spray it with glue. That same glue you've seen me use, that watered down scenic glue. And then I have to spray it all with hairspray, because this is all spices. Spices are edible and will attract insects in some places. I don't really do it so much here where I am, but just in case. I still want to have it just in case. The insects won't eat or be attracted if there's hairspray on everything. It makes it inedible to them. Is a more of a fall color, so we're using a lot more of this than use anything else. This coriander seed. It's good for doing little flowers. It's also good for adding color underneath shrubs and bramble and stuff like that. It's a little tiny yellow grains. Put them together in small clumps, they look a little bit like flowers. Flakes through the road. Add some color. And that's it for the scatter. Thank you. Now the scenic glue dries flat. So when I add anything that has that I want to have a gloss coat, I have to avoid spraying it on there, or I have to add it later. So like this realistic water that I've added on there, I don't want to spray this near it. It'll remove the gloss coat from it, the gloss shine from it. One thing about this scenic glue, it doesn't spray in the most accurate way. And it tends to come out too fast and it splatters things, and it's kind of annoying. But it doesn't atomize very well, the glue, so you're kind of screwed. Sorry about that, I needed to sneeze. Apparently I'm not done. But, yeah, so it comes out too fast. And it tends to blow things around a bit. So you have to prepare for that before you spray. You have to keep that in mind. That some of your scatter is going to move around on you. And you may have to reapply some of it. There's no way to get around that. Now, what you could do, if you wanted to avoid that, is spray everything with hairspray, as opposed to the glue. The problem with the hairspray is glossy. It's not flat. And it's not as sticky. So it's not as good of a glue. You could use photo mount, which is really sticky, but it's also very visible. You'll build up a layer. I wouldn't spray that on my diorama. You could use a matte coat, like a sprayable matte paint. Also, not as adhesive, so it wouldn't work as well. But it would also glue certain things, light, very light things. So there are alternatives, but they're not as good. The sprayable glue is the best. The downside is it doesn't atomize very well, so the spray tends to be a little bit too forceful, and it's indirect, so it's hard to control it. So but I feel confident that, you know, once I spray this with the hairspray and everything, it'll be well glued down. I'm not going to be taking it outside in the garden, so I won't have to worry about stuff being blown around. So it should be fine. Right, so I'll let this dry for about an hour, and then when I come back, I'll spray it with the hairspray. And then, actually no, I think I might do it now. I'm going to do the pigments. I can do the pigments now while this matter. Okay, so I'm going to do some pigments here. Now I've got, these things are garbage. These, to me, the weathering block things. The only thing good about them is the weathering brush that comes in it. And I actually use that as an applicator. The little colors and stuff like that, I just take them out and grind them up. I don't actually use these sets. I just buy them for the brick of pigment. These are too soft. Be used the way that they have them set up. And I mix them together. The colors are way too uniform. So, and I mix them with pastels anyway. So we got, I need some gray pastel. This is how I make pigments. Take a piece of pastel chalk, and I scrape off the colors, do a mortar and pestle. Using a hobby knife. The reason why I like making my own is because I can make the pigments finer than you can in those over-the-counter ones. Over-the-counter ones, I find them too clumpy. The particles are too big. But this, I can make them almost microscopic because I can keep grinding them and grinding them. I mean, you know, I'm sure you could buy the ones that they sell over-the-counter and grind them up too the same way. Just take them out of the jar and put them in a container and grind them up yourself. But they're too expensive. I prefer to save money. And buy them myself. Or make them myself. I think I just made enough pigment there to weather probably 30 tanks. And it cost me about maybe 10 cents. Maybe, I use the two Tamiya puck things, but I could grind up the two, but yeah, there's this color, and probably this color. I could grind the two of them together and make the same color. But a little bit of the black have the same effect. Alright, so now the reason why I'm making this is because I want to put it on the road surface. So I want the rocks that are on there to have one color, and then there's the substrata of the rocks to have another. I don't want it everywhere. This is kind of a dirty, gravelly gray color. And that's pretty much exactly what it's doing. Very good. I don't know how well you guys can see that. I don't know how well the colors will show up because my camera likes to white things out. Using the natural light, the daylight bulbs, always have them. But that doesn't mean that the camera doesn't automatically make adjustments because it thinks it's smart, being helpful. Want it here and there so there's variety in color. hit this with the hairspray, and we'll glue it all down and seal it in. Panther tracks were. I guess you could augment the story for the diorama that the panther was originally parked in that position, then changed position. It's unfortunate that it wouldn't fit. It's kind of annoying me that it didn't. It's one of those. My eyes were bigger than my plan kind of things. It's just me refusing to accept the reality of my situation. That's my diorama wasn't big enough. Technically, the diorama should be almost twice its size in order to correctly depict this kind of situation. But, alright, it's a nice tonal variation to the roadway. I don't know if you guys can see that. I hope you can. I'm going to add a bit of the same color here and there. The top part of the slide. These two mixed together. To do more of the mildew effect on the shed. See it on the camera. I can see it quite well. We're sitting here. The effect of the mildew that I've already painted on. But this will add a slightly different color. Also put some on the ground. well. Ties the two of them together now. Oh yeah, that looks a lot better. That's cool. Alright, now we need some brown dirt. Fresh passage. Blend some of this ground and the patina together. Keep coming in here going, I want a snack, I want a snack, I want a snack, like a broken record. Bits of earth tone here and there, random spots. Trying to add a bit more color, so it's less uniform. Too crazy with one color because then it just returned to the same problem, and that's too much homogeneity or homogeneous color. I find that when you use pigments on top of, if you're not using actual dirt on your diorama to simulate the earth, and you're using sculpt-a-mold or DAS or clay or some other product, you need to add a pigment to it, because the pigment has a 3D texture to it. It's very small, but it still has a 3D texture to it. If you don't add the 3D texture, your mud just looks like all snot a bit. It doesn't have that quality of blended material of tiny stones and large stones and goo and everything that mud tends to take on. So if you don't add tone to it, like texture to it, I don't think it looks right. So okay, I think that's about. I got one more brown in here. Might be too red. Okay. Right. Okay, so that's that for the dry pigments, I think. So I'm going to add to the dry. Yeah, that's what I'm going to add to the dry. So, now, a little bit of hairspray. Make my man cave. Smell like an old lady's salon. Now to add the hairspray, don't just do this, right? Either come way back, like 2 feet, 3 feet, right? Short bursts. Rotate the diorama so it's not all just one direction. Short bursts are key. If you don't do short bursts, you're gonna actually ruin your diorama. You'll coat it and it will be shiny and you'll be screwed. Now, like I said, hairspray is glossy. Glossy on there is okay because you want it to be shiny. It'll save me from having to put a clear coat on. I think. Now, I just had that idea, so I don't know if it'll work. Best laid plans. So my plan is there, is it'll save me a step from having to add a painted gloss coat. I just use the hairspray for the gloss coat. But I have to wait for it to dry. It takes about 15, 20 minutes. I can speed it up with hair dryer, but I don't want to spray hair dryer on there with loose material. It'll go flying all over the room. And the point of the hairspray is to fix the loose material, so that would be kind of silly. So I'm going to let this sit for about 15, 20 minutes and then see how well it held up. And then I'll take a matte coat, which I have, another sprayable matte coat, and spray everything but here, and we'll see how well that holds up. So be back in a few. Hey guys, so right now I have to start getting the vehicles ready to add to the diorama. Now the first thing I want to do is I want to add the mud to the tiger. The tiger has been stuck, so that means it's been sitting there and was spinning its wheels, as they say, for a moment or two before realizing it was stuck, which means it splattered mud up onto itself. So I'm taking a stiff bristled brush, dipping it into a mix of UMP's dark dirt and mud and some light dirt and stuff like that, and flicking it up onto the tank. A little bit of a splatter. don't want much because I don't want to overdo this. It's very easy to overdo it. You just want enough as representation with movement. Using a couple of different kinds of mud for this, the total effect here should be enough. And the reason why I've used more than one color is, to give the effect of dry mud, different colors of dirt that it drove through, and that the tank just didn't appear out of nowhere that day and appear on the diorama and existed nowhere else in history. One of the key phrases for doing dioramas is you want your vehicles to be in the diorama, not on the diorama. So if you can remember that, that's half your battle. The other part of it is what that means, and that's you want your diorama to be, you want your vehicles to be inclusive. So you want your vehicles to be attached into the ground, not onto the ground. They don't want to be sitting on top. So you want the vehicles to be part of the diorama. I mean, that sounds nice and easy, but not necessarily. So one of the things you can do to affect that is by taking colors from the diorama and applying them to the surface of your vehicle. And one way is what I just did there, by splattering it all over. The color that I just splattered there is one of the colors used on the diorama, so that'll help tie the vehicle to it. What I'm doing now is taking the mud, it's a really thin mud mix, it's the same color I just finished splattering all over, painting it on all the visible areas where it'll accumulate. I'll be adding a thicker version of this in just a moment. This is just the start of it. It gets much worse. Now this vehicle is heavily stuck, like very, very, very stuck. So I want a lot of mud. Now when you're putting the mud on, stab your brush. Stab. Don't paint it. You want the brush's bristles to splay out, because it gives it more of a splattered type effect, an impact, a velocity effect on the wheels. And you don't want to completely cover your vehicle anyway, because you'll lose all the hard work you put in there. But you don't want it to be completely innocent of mud, because then it doesn't look realistic. Now this mix that I'm putting on now is a mix of UMP's dark dirt and mud and pigments and homemade pigments and chalk and everything. Is pretty much everything you can imagine, but they're all colors that are used on the diorama to varying degrees. And so they'll fit naturally all over the tank. Also, there's static grass mixed in there. Give an impression of the terrain being caught in there. Like I said, this thing is good and stuck, so there'd be mud quite liberally coated to a lot of it. This isn't the end of it. I don't just go with the mud. I'll have to come back and use pigments as well, to a degree. Do it. Try to make sure you guys can see. So I've got the fine detail of the spider that I put on with the brush, this where I flicked it. And I have a runnier texture that I've added with the thinner mix. And it's also a slightly different color. So that's another layer of texture and color. And now I'm adding a really thick, gloppy mix to the tracks and to the running gear, but not everywhere, not every single bit gets covered. So that's another layer of color and texture. That will hopefully add to the realism. But again, you don't want it everywhere. It's not realistic. It's funny, today I posted the video of the previous work that I've done on this, along with a bunch of pictures and everything on Facebook and all that. I'm watching my iPad here next to me. I've got it muted right now. Going crazy telling me all about it. Actually, in a second, my iTouch is going to go off and tell me to go and start making lunch for my little fella who's sound asleep on the couch. So you're going to hear the alarms going off there in a second. So don't be alarmed, because I won't be. There it is. What did I tell you? What did I tell you? I'll tend to that in a moment. I don't want to get too much of this stuff up on the fenders here. Believe it or not, the fenders were quite effective. A lot of spider got up on them. The denser, heavier stuff tended not to get up on them. They got undercoated quite a bit. Okay. That should do. Now, that I have to let dry so that I can determine its effects to see what it looks like. And then I have to also do the exact same thing in the general area of where the tank is going to be sitting on the diorama. So if the two of them are blended together, and they look like they're supposed to be there. Now I also have to do mud work on the Berg Panther and on the Schwimmwagen, so that they don't look like they're just sitting on top of the diorama. So there's still yet work to be done on that. I'd say we're like in the high 90s, mid 90s percent done. But some of this is the pretty slow part of the work. It's not fast. So that's about what it looks like now. Getting there. A little more. So, be back in a bit.